If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 30 minutes, we have the intro where we just talk about cool stuff like the elimination of team captains in schools. You know, when we were in school back in the day, they used to pick team captains and we would pick the teams. Well, they don't do that anymore because schools have become weak sauce.
They're scared.
We talk about being picked last in school, actually.
Find out who's been picked last.
Yeah. We talk about the recent...
You'll never guess.
The recent heat wave here in the Bay Area, in particular here in San Jose and in Santa Cruz. We talk about Adam's great fall.
Or did Sal push me?
He almost died, but then he didn't. And then we talk about what happened during the ice bath challenge. By the way, that video is on YouTube. You got to check it out. Here's a hint. Body fat helps.
Yeah. Big cakes.
Then we talk about optimizing and balancing the body by focusing on the big rocks. And we also mention the green juice from Organifi. In fact, I made green juice popsicles because it was so hot.
You're still creative.
And they were so refreshing. If you want to get some of those popsicles, you go to Organifi.com.
Popsicles.
That's Organifi.com. Type in the code MINDPUMP for a discount. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, how does one know if they're able to eat intuitively and still reach their personal body goals? What is eating intuitively? What does that mean? Are you ready for it? The next question was, if you were a head coach for a team, how would you run your team? Would you be physically demanding and risk injuries? Or would you take a different approach? In other words, would you injure everybody or would you train them properly? Then we answer the question about plyometrics versus isometrics. Which one is better for sports?
Lots of metrics there.
Yeah, which one's better for sports, powerlifting, and your typical weekend warriors? And finally, is there any friction between me, Adam, Justin, and Doug because of our different lifestyles?
Do we need lube?
And personalities, right. Do we rub hard on each other?
Cause fires.
We talk about that in that particular question. And finally, check it out. This month, if you buy any MAPS program or MAPS bundle, you'll get MAPS Prime for free. MAPS Prime is the program that teaches you how to prime your body properly before your workout. It will literally take your current workout and make it more effective simply by doing a individualized pre-priming session, which Prime teaches you to do. However, there's a caveat. If you enroll in the Super Bundle, which is 1 year's worth of exercise programming and already includes MAPS Prime, we're going to throw in MAPS Prime Pro. Also, if you get the Prime and Prime Pro bundle, which have them all already in there, then we're going to give you MAPS Performance for free. In other words, enroll in any MAPS program, you're going to get some shit for free.
Yeah.
You can find
we
this all at mindpumpmedia.com.
T-shirt time.
Give away some shirts. Give away some shirts.
How are we doing on reviews?
Fold them up and fly them.
19 reviews.
Okay, not bad.
That's not bad. It's not legal. Bad. It's legal.
It's legal. Thank goodness. So we're giving away five shirts, and they're going to the Primal Savage.
Yeah.
Oh.
Mitch Webb, 15, B-Ball. Huey, 5'9". Undefined Lines, 89, and Ashley Stacks. All of you are winners.
Stacks.
Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Thanks, everybody.
Congratulations.
Who's going to be last? Who's going to be last? Adam or Justin?
Justin, of course.
Oh, man.
Slacker, dude.
Yeah. I'm in.
One of these things doesn't belong. Remember that?
No. Sesame Street, yeah.
No, one of these things is not like the other.
Yeah. You know, kids are pussies nowadays because when we were kids, that was the shit we were singing. You know what I'm saying? Like, one of you doesn't belong. You know what I'm saying?
Deal with it.
Gives you thick skin.
Yeah, get the fuck out.
That's it.
You know, they don't
have a weird face.
You know they don't do team captains in schools anymore.
Are you shitting me?
No, you can't.
You can't even be a leader anymore?
No, they don't let you pick teams like that, dude.
It's so discriminatory.
Do you know why?
So one person's not left out.
Because always someone's last.
You know what? I remember that. I remember, you know what's funny, actually? I remember the only time in my life I was in second grade, and it was kickball.
You got picked last?
I got picked last. That was the only time in my life.
They
but you know what, though? That was second grade. I fucking, after that, forever became an athlete. At that point in my life, I was heading down the road of Sal. Yeah. I probably could have been more into encyclopedias and reading had I continued, if I let that discourage me. But instead of that, letting that discourage me, you know what it did, Justin?
Yeah.
It motivated me to be a better...
To be a kickball champion.
To be, kickball champion. Yes.
You know what's interesting is I had that same moment in sports. Like, you know, like I wasn't able to, like, see the field, right? I was sitting on the bench. I was playing baseball, and it just would irritate the shit out of me. But that forced me to get better, and so I got better.
You know, the irony is...
Sports!
The irony is I don't think I ever
really
got
provided
picked.
That.
I don't think I ever got picked last. I swear to God.
That's what you know.
I was always somewhere in the middle getting picked. But, you know, they say the reason why they don't let it happen anymore is because they say it's traumatizing, right? Which I think you guys just fucking proved, since you remember in second grade you got picked last. Good job, Adam. Now they're going to keep not doing it.
Okay, well, I think traumatize is the wrong word, but was it forever
memorable?
Was it forever memorable? Absolutely. Yeah. Now, can something that's forever memorable change you for the good? Absolutely. Does it? And now the question is, do a majority of people, are they motivated by something like that, or are they demotivated? So that would be...
Well, and let's talk about how people respond to criticism and how people don't... They want to completely deflect where they suck, right? Like, they don't want to admit that they're not good at something, right?
Right. Why can't somebody sucks.
Yeah, and why can't somebody else point that out? You know, like, that we're in a world now where you can't even point that out to somebody else. Like, oh, you suck at this.
And you know who ends up pointing? You know what happens anyway?
I do
life?
That to Sal all the time.
You know what happens in life anyway? Life will point shit out to you.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Yeah. So Wouldn't you rather come from like a friendly face?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You imagine you're like, you graduate. That's what's happened sometimes. You know, these kids graduate college and they're like, yes, I'm fucking great at everything. Like everything I've ever done.
Yeah.
All
I don't
A's.
Think I've ever
All
sucked.
A's.
Fuck, I meet so many kids.
All
like
A's.
That.
Then they go to, you have an F in life.
Yeah, they're just, oh my God, I'm the best.
All A's
of this.
In school,
oh,
F in life.
Then they go apply at a company. And
no, you're not.
They apply at a company and you know, they're getting interviewed by the HR manager. HR manager's looking at the resume and like, okay, so says here you have no experience whatsoever. You have a degree in basket weaving and classical history. And you would like to the position of CEO.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, hand it to me, please.
Yeah. How does that work? Yeah. How does that work out? Yeah. So this weekend, I think we were on the sun this weekend. San Jose was closer to the sun
than
normal.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Why was it so fucking hot?
It was like Mercury.
Hottest day of the year for us, I believe, right?
I don't remember it ever being that hot.
115 at one point.
It was something weird. It was so hot it was weird.
It was.
Yeah.
It didn't make sense.
This is strange.
How hot was it in Santa Cruz?
Yeah, it was like, I'm not even joking. It was 115. And then it was like 111 in the shade.
In Santa Cruz?
This is fucking weird.
Oh my God.
I thought we finally calmed down, but that was one day.
I thought we pay these astronomical prices to live here to not have that. That's why we fucking...
We don't even have cactuses. What the hell's going on?
Yeah, it was bullshit. Did you guys go swimming and shit all day long or what?
Yeah, I went in the ocean, man. I had to get in some cold water. Like, we were there all day. Was it Saturday? Yeah, we were there Saturday. And I'm not usually a big beach person, because especially because, like, everybody and their mother, you know, drives across the hill and, like, it's just a clusterfuck.
Was it crowded? I'm sure it was crowded.
Well, I went to one that, you know, I'm not even going to say, because I don't want people to go there.
Oh, you're one of those people.
Yeah, but, we got there and it was, like, you know, it was still crowded for what it was, but, you know, it was fine because, like, at least that way we had access to the beach and we could go in the water. And so we were there, like, the entire day. I was in the water. I'd get out, and the sand was so fucking hot. You know, it was just, everything was just, like, emanating heat. I had to be in the water.
Oh, yeah, we went to the pool. Me and the kids were in the pool all day long, which was a lot of fun. But, yeah, man, it was... I mean, it hit 115 here in San Jose. It reminded me of when I lived in Palm Desert. That kind of heat, like when you get in the car, and you can't touch anything in the car.
Yeah,
you can't.
It's like you open the oven and it just this blast of heat.
It was nasty. Thankfully, I have AC. Do you guys have AC?
I only have
it in my house.
I only have it in my master bedroom. So everything else in the house is not AC. And even then, we were blasting it 24/7 for 2 days straight, and it could never get my room below 70. It just couldn't get it below 70. It was too much. It's crazy. I had ice packs on me all week, weekend long. And eventually, and I had them on my back, but I was like, ended up putting them all over my body. just keep them coming.
Dude.
Like,
oh yeah, dude, how is your back, by the way?
Yeah.
You got to tell the audience what happened.
So
we were worried about you.
I'm a bit fucked up. I'm not gonna lie.
He's trying to wrestle Doug.
I tried to wrestle the chimp, dude.
Doug suplexed
him. Fucked up. So you know, I'm not one to bitch and moan when I because I've been hurt plenty of times playing sports my whole life. That was the first time, though, I've ever fallen off a fucking 10-foot ladder and landed on my back. That's for sure.
I don't think it's 10 feet, though.
It is 10 feet.
It is a 10-foot ladder?
Yeah, it is 10-foot
ladder. Dude, so all I remember was, because you were on the top of the ladder, we were trying to put the ice bath tub, because we were done with our ice bath challenge, which, by the way, if you haven't seen it, go to YouTube. Fucking hilarious. We're going to talk about that, too, in a second, because I want to make sure I defend myself for losing.
Here we go.
But we were putting the tub up, so Adam's on the top of the ladder, and me and... Was it you, Doug? Were you helping with us?
No, it was you and Taylor.
Oh, me and Taylor. We were pushing it up to help him, and it's really awkward. Yeah. And so I'm looking... I'm not looking at Adam. I'm kind of looking away because I'm the way I'm positioned. And all of a sudden, the tub is out of my hands, and I hear... And I hear Adam... Ugh. That's the sound you made. It was like, ooh,
well, it knocked the
like
air
a
out of
body
me.
Hit.
It knocked the air out of me.
And I look over, and Adam's kind of on his side.
Yeah, I caught the end of it.
Bro,
I just caught Adam with his hands and his legs up, you know, in the air.
For
like, what the fuck?
For a split second, dude, I'm like, oh fuck, we're gonna have to get Bradley Martin to be our new host.
Yeah.
Or someone like that. You know what I mean?
Should, yeah.
I somebody thought he might have died.
Handsome and opinionated.
But you, know you but you didn't break shit.
I didn't.
You're way more resilient than you would
think.
You
want to know what's funny.
Because you fell from a high position.
Well, no, it fucked me up. My left side of my back is swollen. I definitely have not been able to train. It hurts to twist. Like, I'm definitely, it got me for sure. I don't think I did any structural damage. I don't think I broke, compressed, cracked.
You felt like
bruised the shit out of it.
Yeah, I think I bruised my ribs. Yeah, I think I might have bruised my ribs.
And you fell right on your side, right?
Yeah, it was like side back, right? So I was.
That's smart, because had you posted with your arm, that might have been bad.
You know what? You know what? So yesterday, what was the most sore? How funny is this? Was my core, my abs, because I must have braced so hard before I hit. I must have tensed up super hard, and then taking that impact,
it knocked the wind out of you, right?
Yeah, it knocked the wind out of me, just a little bit, not real bad. And it reminded me, so I wrecked my ATV. I was hitting tabletop jumps, and I was driving my buddies, and my buddy has a twist throttle and I have a thumb throttle. I'm just so I'm not used to it. And I went into the jump, and they get a lot of power, so it pulled me back. And when it pulled me back, the natural reaction was to grip down on the throttle, and that I gripped down on it and it took off on me. And so I went up this jump. It already riding a wheelie into the jump, so it automatically sent me in that back rotation when I hit, because it's a tabletop, so it's a steep ass lip, and so it threw me. And so if you can imagine, I was starting to do a barrel roll with an ATV, you know, off a monster jump.
That's horrible.
And so I bailed, I pushed away from it, but I was a good probably 12-15 feet in the air and landed flat on my tailbone. That one really knocked the air out of me. But the same thing, like the adrenaline from the fear and the rush of you know, bailing from that and knowing you're going to crash and get hurt, that was like the shock. Like, I hop right up. Like, I don't even feel the injury. I don't feel it till like the next day. This was kind of like that, although I started to feel this in the evening time. I was like, oh, fuck. Oh, I feel it today already. Like, oh, tomorrow will be bad. I went, but right away, though, I mean, I was on it, man. I hit the red light therapy for about 15 minutes before I left here. Then I went and saw Dr. Brink, and I got in, did the cryotherapy, then had him do laser on me.
Taking the turmeric for the inflammation?
Oh, yeah. I took turmeric. I've had nothing but veggies and fish and stuff like that. So I've been on
all the anti-inflammatory.
Yeah, all the anti-inflammatory stuff. And I've been icing like for 20 minutes on, 30 off, 20. I've been doing that like crazy. So I've definitely been staying on top of it and feel pretty damn good considering what happened to me.
Well, people died from falling off a fucking ladder, dude. All the time.
Yeah, it was a nasty fall, man. It's up there with some of the better crashes that I've had in my life. The one I was saying, I cracked my coccyx, which, talk about, that's a shitty one because they can't do shit about that. So I went and saw, I had x-ray. They had to rush me to the hospital for that because I'm driving home, and I know I'm in pain. It was a similar pain, like just landing on your back like that. I knew, like, oh, it did not feel good. And we're driving home, and all of a sudden I lose all of feeling in my right leg, and I fucking freak out. I mean, I cannot feel, like, it went from just kind of hurting my back to we're driving home, and then all of a sudden, whoop, can't feel my whole right side. And so like, go to the ER. We rushed the ER, and so obviously my back had got so swollen that it, you know, pinched the nerve, and then it got numb. Jeez. But that it reminded me of that fall when I went down, and thinking, oh God, like, I hope this is not one of those things that I can't do anything. Because that one laid me up for a solid week. I was laid up from that and couldn't really do anything but ice and just lay around. You can't do anything for a cracked coccyx. So I was afraid that I might have done some damage like that on this one, but I think I just have like a slight bruised rib maybe. It just fucking hurts.
Well, I'm glad you
it just fucking hurts.
From me to you, buddy, I'm glad you didn't die. Yeah. That's a good thing. But yeah, let's talk about that ice bath challenge. Let's talk about what's going on.
Well, let's hear your excuse. So you got to go twice, bro.
No. So, there's two reasons why I went. Here's why I went twice, because I went first, which is...
You volunteered, by the way.
I volunteered to go first, and which means I didn't know, you know, kind of what I was competing against. So it's very difficult because I'm just going based off of whatever.
Right.
I went again because I wanted to see if I could best my time, which I did. The second time I went longer than the first time. But one thing you'll see, and if you do special, like if you really pay attention and you do study and you look at the animals of the Arctic, the ones that submerge themselves in Arctic waters and that can stay submerged, they all have a nice layer of sea blubber, which will insulate
them. Fuck you for where you're trying to go with this.
Which insulates them from ice.
Correlate here.
And so you don't see a lot of like shredded walruses or stuff like that, right? Because they need the insulation from the water. So it was difficult.
It means, you know, some people have weak minds.
Because you're so lean, and that's what it is.
Yeah. It was difficult.
They're not able to really be in tune with their body, right?
I actually thought, and I was okay with this. I had decided it was so fucking cold that when you started saying that you wanted to go a second time to try and push, I was ready to concede and say, I don't care to win that bad to go back in that motherfucker. And yet you still wanted to go, and then you still lost, bro. Yeah. You got two times.
I did.
Because if I got a second time, I might have been able to muster it up enough to go after Justin's time, but I was just like not having it.
It's fucking hard, man. It's very difficult.
If I went first, you wouldn't even have tried twice.
That's probably right. Yeah. No, I would have. I would have fought for second.
Yeah,
but the Wim Hof breathing. That's all joking aside. That's fucking amazing, huh? Makes that big of a difference. Well, when you first went in before all that, you did all the training. Was it different? How did it work? Did they have you do the training first?
Well, I think it's more like gaining access to calming, you know, your autonomic system. So for the most part, like the breathing just helps you to get in tune with, you
get
know,
connected
feeling
to that, right?
Yeah, because it honestly, I didn't do any of the breathing or anything in prep to going into that. I just knew I was trying to, spend some time by myself to really kind of access that again and get that calmness and to be able to relax as quickly as possible getting into that. Mm-hmm. And that way I was able to not, what I did notice with you guys is you were answering questions. You're really, really tense and you're trying to squeeze all those answers out. And I just knew that was destined to failure. Mm. So,
you didn't just beat us. You dusted us. Like it wasn't even close.
Yeah. Three times. That
yeah.
I
would you like six yeah. minutes or something ridiculous
yeah,
like that?
Yeah, it was
that?
Over yeah, 6 minutes. It was
over
yeah,
6 minutes.
That's ridiculous, bro. Yeah.
That hurt. I mean, I'm not going to lie. Like, at a certain point, like, I was able to relax through most of it, but I think it was around like the last, it was like 5 minutes maybe mark. I was just like, oh shit. Like, I'm losing. Like,
so when you got out, I was going to ask you that because I didn't really get to ask you that. When you got out, did part of you get out because you're like, fuck, I don't want to be in here anymore?
No, I got like scared.
I felt like once you got to a certain point, I'm like, fuck, he's going to go all day.
I could have even gone longer, but what caused me to get out was really that, like, I didn't have, you know how your arms go to sleep Yeah. And so my arms went to sleep. Then it felt like all the way into like my chest was starting to go to sleep.
Oh, that would freak me out.
So
my heart's going to go to sleep real soon.
Yeah, I swear to God, I started to feel like, I was like, oh no. Like my whole body is going limp and I'm not going to, like, I felt like I was just going to slide in and then you guys are going to have to pull me out. Cause like I didn't really feel any motor control after a while. I was like, oh shit. Like my arms weren't working. My legs were getting really numb. Like everything had, like, I didn't really have access to it really anymore. So I had to get out while I still had a little bit.
So many people inbox me talking shit like it's all easy. And I used to do that in football. I'm like,
send a video.
Yeah, exactly.
Send a video, asshole.
Send a fucking video. And let me tell you.
Well, hold on. Make sure you know the dangers of it because I don't want some asshole to be like, fucking stay in there for 15 minutes. And next thing you know, we got a hypothermia or something.
Well, yeah, that's what I mean. It is fucking dangerous. And there's that mental side of it where, like, I was wondering of Justin exactly that. Because when he got out, his skin looked burned. He was so fucking. Looked like
I was burned a little. Yeah, my skin.
Yeah, it looked like you were gonna get frostbite all on this perfect line across your chest and your arms,
right above your nipples.
Yeah, that's right. Then you have to really like move, like get your core temperature up after you're done. So that's all part of the process afterwards too, to kind of come out of it.
We gotta do one in the sauna next.
My bones were still cold.
You'll kill me on
2 hours later.
Sure. Yeah,
2 hours later, my teeth were still chattering. Yeah. Dude, I was like, dude, I think he froze my bones a little bit, and they're still defrosting right now because I'm still chattering.
You did it at a good time, though, because it was so hot that day that we didn't even realize until we got out, and it was like, it took all day for me to warm up.
So I did, because I went first, I did pee in there a little bit, so I want to tell you guys now on the podcast.
I thought I tasted something salty.
Familiar.
Yeah. And then you got back in it again?
Yeah, well, that's mine. it's my pee, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not a big deal.
Your brand.
No, that was cool. That was fun, though. That was a good time. I thought that was, and I'm hoping, you know, Ben Pekulski hit me up and asked me about the specs and how much ice we used and everything like that. So I don't know. I'm calling him out right now. So those of you guys that are listening, go over there and bombard his Instagram and talk some shit to him, because he did text me and ask me all the specs like he was going to do it. So he was one of those guys that was talking shit like that's no big deal. So I'm calling him out.
Oh,
right now.
Let's see it.
How did you guys feel later in the day after that? Was any effect on your sleep or anything like that?
I mean, I felt amazing afterwards.
That's what I was going to say. It does.
I mean,
it's invigorating.
I've talked about this on the show a little bit. Like, I've taken, and I don't remember, I think I got it off of Wim Hof's Instagram or fucking his blog or something. I don't know where I got it. But, you know, he had this little thing that, like, to help teach people that are like just starting to get acclimated, because obviously if you haven't trained to do this or focus on your breathing, like Justin said, been connected to that, you know, throwing somebody in an ice bath and saying see how long you can stay in there the first time is probably not the way you work up to this. So I was doing the shower.
It wasn't just staying in there though; we had to answer questions.
Yeah, right.
That was a whole nother wrinkle.
Right. And which I think that's what some of these guys that are like, you know, we're football players and they put half their body in. They're like, oh, I used to sit in an ice bath after football practice all day long and shit. I'm like, okay, dude. Well, fill it all.
I did too, and guess what? It was only to my waist.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Come on. Get
yeah,
the
you
got
to get.
Here.
We were in there up to our like chest and shoulders.
No,
yeah.
I was. All the
literally
way to
takes
neck,
your breath
dude.
Away.
Yeah, yeah, all the way to your. It was right up to
take
the
my
neck.
Breath
But I used to do the Wim Hof at the end of your shower, 15 seconds of cold, then 30 seconds of cold, then 45 seconds of cold, then 1 minute of cold. Like, so you do every week, you progress it by 15 to 30 seconds, right? And man, I would notice a huge difference when I get out of the shower just from doing that. I mean, you're aside from just being alert at the obvious, right? Put me through cold water, of course you're gonna wake up. But you really do. I feel the spike in energy, and it stays with you for quite some time. It's not like this shock and it wakes you up.
Oh yeah, it's addictive, man.
Yeah, and you know you know that we've been doing that forever, right? Remember when you used to be half asleep and throw cold, freezing cold water on my face before I go drive, and it's 3 o'clock in the morning or something crazy like that. I mean, it's something that it's just natural to do that, right?
Yeah, I do that on days where I know I have to be like clear and focused and sharp for that day. Like, I'll take a really cold shower first thing in the morning.
Right. I think it's a smart strategy. I feel mentally clear. I feel way more alert and awake. Like, it's definitely, and when you go to that extreme, I feel like you see even more of that, right? Like if you take a little bit of a cold shower, I feel a little more alert, a little more awake than I normally do if I take a warm shower. You sit in an ice bath like that for fucking a couple minutes, like you get out. I am woke. Yeah, the fuck?
You're woke.
I'm woke.
You're woke, son.
All day.
Yeah, my favorite thing to do with that is the contrast where you go from sauna then to something like that.
I did that at Ben Grieffel's house. That was really cool.
Oh, yeah. That's a whole nother level, man. And you feel amazing afterwards.
So like, some of your good spas will have that, right? So or you've been up now to
Refuge
that is like that. I love that. That's my favorite thing to do too. Although I can only handle about three rounds of that, and then after about three rounds, it starts to I can feel my system's fatiguing. So
that
you know,
isn't that interesting?
It is interesting.
I noticed the same thing.
That's a good point. You know, well, think about it. If it's like any other system of the body, right?
You can fatigue it,
and if you overtrain it, I can tell after about three rounds of hot, cold plunges like that, it's definitely working my body, and my body normally tells me right about round three that, okay, Adam, no more of this or else you're probably going to push yourself too far. I even almost feel like if I keep doing this, I could get sick because I just feel worn out.
You can train this system because you can get better at it, and then think of all the other things that your body ends up becoming stronger with because you've strengthened this particular system. Think of the carryovers. It's not that different from building your cardiovascular endurance or your strength in the sense that you notice all this carryover to other parts of your life. When you strengthen your body's ability to acclimate to heat and cold, you also get a lot of this carryover. It's a system of the body, and it's something you can train and exercise. I'm a firm believer in it because I've experienced it myself, and the science supports it.
In my opinion, when I think about things, we always talk about paradigm shattering things or game changers for us. As far as I used to get sick all the time. All the time I used to get sick. And the two biggest things that have made the difference, I feel personally for me, one was starting the hot cold training and incorporating that, because I'm pretty consistent with that. Not a month goes by where I'm not at the Refuge or I don't find a hot cold plunge type of situation where I can do that. Or I mean, even when we were on the cruise we were just on, we signed up for the sauna in there, and I was doing the sauna, then cold shower, sauna, cold shower. So I do this quite a bit. Increasing my veggie target. So making sure that I'm getting sick, and because 6 to 8 servings is tough, I've now introduced, you know, the green juice from Organifi and using that. So those two things, have been the biggest game changer for me for like warding off getting sick.
Yeah, that's interesting to put that together, because like thinking about all the times I actually did get sick, it's either, I mean, obviously I've worn my body down like stress wise. Usually it's like, it's this buildup of like all these different days in a row, the string of days in a row, where I've just been constantly at it. And then there was a shift in either temperature, environment, or something drastic, you know, like that did this to my body to where like I was trying to react to some new stimulus, and it was like, put me out.
Right.
Know? Yeah.
There's definitely something to it. I don't know if there's necessarily any science to support it yet, but the anecdote is strong enough, right? How many times have you heard people say, going from, you know, too much contrast, AC to heat, AC to heat.
When you think about it, you say there's no science, but it's, if you break down the real basic stuff, I feel like it's almost obvious. Think about it.
What I mean by no science, I don't know if they've done a direct study.
Right, direct, yeah. No, yeah. I get what you're saying, but I mean, there's plenty of stuff to point that, you know, strengthening any of your body's systems is going to have carryover to aiding and helping the other ones, and weakening or not training a system is going to hinder some of the other systems. I mean, that's just the bottom line.
You're right. You're absolutely right that there are some things that are really fucking obvious that we don't need science to. You don't need a specific study to
define it.
No, like if I'm going to go to the doctor and I have an ailment, and I asked the doctor, hey, does my diet affect this? And the doctor says, no, we don't have any studies to support it. Like, I know common sense says that how I eat is going to affect anything. So no matter what ailment I have, I can probably improve upon it by adjusting
my nutrition. Right, it's probably not going to, that virus, you know, what you eat may not affect that exact virus, but the systems of your body that help fight off that virus and regenerate new cells and make other, you know what I'm saying? Like, that does a lot to do with nutrition. So why wouldn't it aid in that? And so, to me, those types of things just are...
Dude, the frustration I had going to the oncologist with my family member who had cancer, and for the oncologist to say, specifically, nothing you do with your diet is going to make a difference, so don't even worry about it. Eat whatever you want. I'm sitting there like, are you, I want to rip my hair out of my head. Like, I can't believe. And then you have to kind of debate, you know, with the oncologist after you leave, like, okay, I know they said this, but you can definitely help with these types of foods. And it's bullshit. It's absolute bullshit. You're right. There's a lot of obvious things that we don't need studies for. And you're right. This is definitely one of them.
Well, and this is, again, going back to, and I know what we built and started Mind Pump on was that message of, you know, the supplement industry and how they promote things. And it's just like, it's not that we're saying that supplements can't be used and they're not beneficial. It's like, there's much bigger rocks to address. And in my opinion is getting each one of your systems operating correctly and optimally. If you can do little things, whether that be getting sleep, exercising properly, not pushing the body to failure all the time, you know, eating balanced meals. If you can do some of these things, not eating in a caloric surplus all the time, you know, all these things are going to get each one of your body's systems running more properly, which that is going to aid in your fat loss journey or muscle building journey more than almost any supplement out there.
It's true. And there's also this, there's also this shift in thinking in the sense that we identify systems of the body when in reality it's a system.
Right.
It's one system.
It really is.
Yeah. So when you go, you know, you have an ailment and you think, oh, I have an issue with my bones or with my kidneys or with my heart or with my, you know, my nervous system. We isolate different systems of the body and think of them as being autonomous and doing their own thing when in reality it's not. It's all one system, even though we, I know why we divide them up because that's how we learn specifics about them. But in reality, it's all
specialize
one,
around
it's,
it.
It's all one system. So if you have, a symptom that's being expressed in one symptom, like a neurological disorder, well, I know that optimizing all of my systems is really optimizing the one system that encompasses even this, you know, this nervous system issue or whatever. So that was a big one for me, is just looking at the whole thing and saying, wait a minute, it's not one, it's not piecemeal, it's all one. If I can work on the whole thing, then it's all going to work better, well, regardless of what.
And then I think when you understand that, and if you're somebody who's just here to lose weight or build muscle, which is a large portion of people, you start to prioritize a little bit different. So instead of getting so hung up on the latest and greatest thing to do or take, it's like, what are some things that I can do already to improve one of my systems? And like I gave the examples of, you know, the sleep, because that's normally one of them. It's like, dude, if sleep and stress are major things in your life right now and you're trying to lose 15 pounds, like you want, even more than probably your working out will benefit, is actually addressing the stress, addressing the lack of sleep, addressing these types of issues.
It seems counterproductive, but when you really like dive into that and you see all the benefits it provides and you already being in this really high state, you know, like adding another element of stress, whether it's physical stress, what is that really going to do, you know, for your current state where you are right now? Like if you just mend, like think about what that will do for your metabolism and all the rest of the
systems. Think about it this way. If you think of a human person, a human body and everything that it encompasses, everything from their mind to their whatever, everything, right? And then you list the most important things that will determine the survival and the flourishment or of this particular human, what would you list? Okay. You would list sleep, food, shelter, water, breathing. Like what are things that you can't do without as a human? Like the most important things.
Right.
Okay. Now just optimize those.
Right.
And you've taken care of almost everything. Like breathing. How long can a human go without breathing?
Right.
You need that. That's optimal. Do you think that optimizing how you breathe could influence your health?
Breathing. Yeah.
You better fucking believe it. In fact, it's one of the most important things because breathing, in fact, is essential.
Right.
Same thing with just eating and just moving and, you know, your state of mind. Like these are so much more important than all these little tiny things that we try to place importance upon. We almost dismiss all those things. We don't even think about them.
Right. Yeah.
But we know they're super important when you start to think of the body as a whole. So just interesting stuff. By the way, talking about the green juice, you know what I did with the green juice?
Right.
Because it was so hot, is I made the one thing I don't like about the green juice, it's kind of tongue in cheek, is it tastes really fucking good. So it's like you want to drink it all the time. Right? So I made it into popsicles. I got ice cubes and
that's a good idea.
And I put popsicle sticks in there,
ah,
and then pull them out, and it's freaking hot. And
oh,
just,
that actually tastes good, huh?
They're really
huh.
good.
Well, I mean, the drink tastes good. I wouldn't think to make it a popsicle.
Well, but when it's cold, it's even better.
Oh, I bet.
Yeah. So well, I was
especially
just,
with these last couple of days.
I was just doing that. It's hot, and I'm like, all right, this is good for me. It tastes good.
It's become a staple for me. I mean, I just... Right now, too, because I'm not trying to, I was on the build, and so then I was eating quite a few meals, so I'm not eating that many meals right now a day, and so it's even harder for me to get all my veggies in, so it's pretty much just become a regular, I'm drinking that every day right now, but I enjoy it, it's refreshing, it's hot, it's, it tastes good, cool, shake it up with a little bit of ice, it doesn't take much, so.
Minty fresh.
I'm a big fan.
Yeah, it's good.
Bring on the Organifi, Bert.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First up is AlexZald99. How does one know if they're able to eat intuitively and still reach their personal body goals?
What a great question.
This is a very good question.
You know why I like this question? Because of all the things I've ever said on Mind Pump, easily the most misunderstood thing I've ever said is all in regards to eating intuitively. In fact, I have clients that I coach, you know, virtual clients. And they'll be like, oh, I ate intuitively yesterday, and I'll look at their nutrition, and it's like, I was at a party, so I just ate intuitively. Yeah,
intuitively.
And so they ate like burgers and fries and pizza
for
and
my
cupcakes.
Cravings.
And so people confuse eating intuitively with just not giving a fuck or eating whatever they want. It's not the same thing. So number one, okay, and eating intuitively, you have to understand, eating intuitively is being connected to your body, being connected to what your body really needs.
Can we start before you go on and explain this too? Because I think this is another thing that people misunderstand. There is a very, 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 very small, in fact, it's probably right up there with what we talked about the other day on the show about how many people are actually billionaires and make $100 million in companies. Mm. This is up there, okay? This is like the one percenters, dude. There's not a lot of people that can truly, truly intuitively eat. I want to put that out there, yeah, as you explain this.
Not right off the bat. It's no,
or ever.
It's no different than here. Okay. Eating intuitively is not as hard as being a billionaire. It's as common as being a billionaire now.
Yeah, fair enough.
But it's not as hard. I could teach people to become intuitive with their diet. Way easier than I could ever teach people to become billionaires or build a 400 pound bench press or a 500 pound squat or anything like that. Like, it doesn't require those levels of genetics and stuff like that. In fact, everybody has the capability.
Fair enough.
To eat intuitively. The problem is that in today's modern life, we are taught not just to not eat intuitively, we're taught to ignore our bodies to the point where, mm-hmm, if I tell someone to do anything intuitively, they have no fucking idea what that means. They have zero idea. Nobody knows what real hunger feels like because we eat on a regular schedule, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And if you're in fitness, even worse, you're eating every 2 or 3 hours. If you're trying to gain weight, you ignore the signals of feeling stuffed or bloated or I don't want to eat this. So you end up becoming robotic about it. If you're trying to lose weight, you ignore the signals of hunger and cravings and needing variety, and I'm just going to force feed myself this particular food or whatever. If you're just a regular person, the only thing you eat intuitively on is your emotions. So it becomes an emotional thing. Like, I feel like eating, you know, this is what people will say, like, what do you feel like eating right now? Let me think. What do I feel like eating? Like, that's not intuitive. What they're feeling like doing is they're going in their emotions and thinking like, what's going to make me feel happy?
This is how,
right now.
This is really easy. How does one know if they're able to eat intuitively and still reach their personal goals? If you have to ask, it's not you. That's a pretty simple one because I think of intuitive eating as like, you have trained, I think, to get yourself in shape and tracked and paid attention to all these things and connected the dots In other words, you've been practicing, you know, playing the game for a long time.
For like decades.
Yes, before somebody just walks away and says, I'm not going to track.
Dude, because even then, I mean, and you bringing up this point a lot, like as far as like how much education needs to be established before you can even think about sort of removing yourself from reading labels and understanding, you know, what macronutrients, you know, I should balance out and, you know, about how many calories I should fluctuate, you know, throughout the week and, you know, here and, you know, what's my body composition. And like, there's a lot of due diligence that you really need to consider before you even bring up this conversation.
Yes. And here's what you need to understand is that your body, it has the capability to tell you exactly what you need when you need it. It's there. The signals are actually finely tuned through hundreds of thousands of years of evolution. Humans knew instinctively when they needed to go lick a rock for minerals and salt.
Right.
When they needed to eat certain plants.
You still see that with pika eating, right?
Exactly. Women. When they needed to eat, go hunting and eat meat, or when they could, you know, forage more, or and it's all finely tuned. It's all there. When they needed to drink water. None of them had schedules. None of them carried food with them. It was all there, but they were in touch with their body. So before you can even think about eating intuitively, you have to like erase how you've been living by becoming more in touch with these things. So there's a few steps that I recommend to people to get themselves to this place. Now, for number one, it's for the most part, most people have to completely eliminate all processed and highly engineered foods.
I think you have to have gone through an elimination diet at one point in your life before you can. Otherwise, how can you have ever said that you've truly pulled these things? And that's just the common thing.
Well, how
right?
do you know how they affect you?
Right.
So that's all part of the process of being aware. And so like these various stages that you can take towards intuitive eating, but definitely being aware of how each one of these food groups affects your body and what kind of signs and signals it provides is so paramount.
Yeah, I'm totally going to get there. So you start by eliminating all these processed and engineered foods. Now, here's why. Not because they're not healthy for you. They definitely aren't healthy for you. But the reason why we're eliminating them to become more intuitive is because these are foods that are engineered by humans to hack your body's systems and signals. They're designed to make you crave more, eat more, and to want more. They're engineered to be that way. So you can't trust your body's signals when they're being hacked by these foods. This is a fact, okay? So there are flavors available and combinations available on the market at every store that your body did not encounter when it was evolving these signals. It's just a fact. Like the sweet and the salty and the texture and the chemicals and the preservatives and the colors, all these things influence your body's systems of signaling, and they've hacked you so much that unless you remove them, you don't know what you're reading. You're reading something that's totally hacked. So that's number one. Number two, then you go into an elimination diet where you eliminate common food intolerances so that you can see how your body reacts to them when you start to reintroduce them. And the reason why this is important is you want to make associations with food aside from the emotional associations and the way they taste, because those are the only two associations that most people have, is how they make me feel emotionally. I'm happy, I'm eating this cake or whatever, and it tastes good. There are other associations that we ignore, like my digestion, my mood, my skin, my bloated, like all these different things.
Energy,
like once
sex drive. There's so many things.
Exactly. Once you can connect those dots, then you make those associations, and before you know it, you will start to learn to appreciate those foods for different things that you normally weren't paying attention to. The third thing is, and this is for healthy individuals, learn how to fast. Mm-hmm. The reason why I'm saying you need to learn how to fast isn't because fasting is good for you, although it is.
You got to learn that signal that what you used to think was your hunger signal.
That's it. You got to go without.
Yeah.
You got to go without, and I'd say start with a, you know, 16 to 24 hour fast. But then when you get good at it, go for like 3 days of a fast, because you will become much more in tune with what your body really needs when you go without
totally
for a long period of time. And then the other thing is when you're eating, slow the fuck down.
Yeah. Chew every morsel.
One of the most mindless things we do when we do in our lives is eat. There's almost nothing that we do that's as mindless as eating. Think about it this way. When was the last time you ate in a quiet setting without your phone, without TV, without movies, without music? Nothing. It's almost never. Nobody ever does that. If they are by themselves when they eat, they're on their phone or they're watching TV or they're watching a movie. And so it becomes a mindless activity to where I'm filling up the space while I'm watching this particular thing. You have to do this. And by the way, that's okay once you become connected to your body. But right now it's not. If you're in this particular, you know, phase of trying to become more intuitive, find those times, sit down, no distractions. It's just you and your food. Don't drink anything with your food so that you have to chew it, and literally pay attention to the way the food tastes, to how many times you need to chew it, to when you swallow it, to how you feel, and stop eating when you feel when you're satisfied, not when you're stuffed. That's the other thing you want to pay attention to, is that many of us are taught to eat till we're stuffed. So those steps that I just outlined right there will take you so far, but it takes a while. I'm not going to lie to you. If you're really training to the point where, and you pay attention to this and you make this something that you're conscious of, like, okay, I want to become more intuitive with my eating. If you're really, really good, you might be able to do it in half a year. Most people are going to take a year or longer. No joke. It takes that long because it is such a, we have unlearned this natural system with our bodies to the point where when I get people to do this, it's like they're figuring it out the entire time. But once you get there...
Dude, it doesn't end, at least in my opinion. I mean, I'm still piecing little things together about myself. I mean, even to the point...
Yeah, I don't think there's a goal. I don't think it's like, boom,
we were just talking about how the hot and cold showers and the green juice, like, these are things that are still unfolding and revealing themselves to me now. Like, wow, what you need is you need enough data, right? You need enough consistency to be able to say for sure that, oh, wow, when I eat all my veggies consistently for long periods of time, I do stay much healthier. And then, wow, when I do miss that for a long periods of time, I do tend to get more sick. And that needs to happen to me, not once, not twice, but that's happened now enough times where it's like, okay, now I can draw the conclusion that that's what it is. So it takes time to do all
this. Totally.
This.
And by the way, this should be your goal. And you can have this goal of becoming more intuitive and learning to read. First of all, learning to read your body signals and then learning to eat according to them, while you're following your goal of trying to lose weight or gain weight. So it's not one or the other. You can track, you can have macro targets and calorie targets and say, okay, I want to lose weight, so this is what I need to eat. This is what my coach is trying to do. And at the same time, learn how to read your body signals and learn how to eat more intuitively. In fact, it's probably more effective to start that way anyway. We always recommend people start out by tracking. My client Andrew, who was in here with, I'm working with Andrew right now. He came in here when we did the trainer episode. He's at a point now, dude, he's like tripping out. He's like, dude, I walk around with a six pack like all the time, like, and I'm not even trying. He's like, I used to have to work so hard to get lean and then I'd get out of it. And he goes, now I just kind of maintain this. And he's like, it feels almost effortless. Now, I've been working with this guy for months and months, and he's also a personal trainer, so he accelerated a lot faster than most people would. But it's really a trip, so it should be your goal, because if you want this to be a lifelong thing where, you know, you're fit and healthy, and you also don't want to have to stress about it all the time, because let me tell you, if your exercise and diet become an added stress on your life, it's not going to last very long. It's going to become a short-lived thing, and it might actually take away from your quality of life.
I know we've spent a lot of time on this already, but I do think it's important to note this, that, you know, this person has a personal body goal right now too, and that's really tough if you have like extreme goals, or let's say I want to lose 30 pounds of body fat, or I want to build a bunch of muscle.
Right.
Like, you need to be pretty comfortable with your physique kind of where it is. And that, like, that's a part of the reason why, too, I think it works so well for Sal, is he's broken through those old insecurities from what he had when he was younger, that he's very comfortable in his skin. He's very comfortable with his physique. Sure, there's times when he wants to be a little bit leaner than others, so he makes a little effort towards being more disciplined or restricting or kicking up his activity level or whatever. But for the most part, is always intuitive. A lot of that comes with... him not having these huge body goals. I guarantee if you were to ask him, hey, Sal, do you know, get up to 240, I guarantee he would probably want to be able to track in order to do that, because that's just a major goal to try and achieve that without really putting the numbers in. The same thing would go for somebody who has a major physique goal where they're trying to change quite a bit.
Yeah, when you're extreme, it's a little different. But like I said, if you have body goals, you can do it at the same time. You can kind of become more intuitive while tracking, while adding things up, and if anything, as you become more intuitive with your tracking, even if your goals are extreme, they will help you in the direction to become more efficient and effective with what you're doing. So even though you may be doing things, like Adam said, if you want to be a 240-pound, you know, monster in the gym or get super shredded beyond what you may be optimal health, if you're intuitive about it, you'll be able to navigate through it and make better decisions along the way anyway. So it's not something you have to put on the back burner. It's something I think you can do no matter what. But
you're working towards it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Quick commercial break, you guys. We keep getting asked all the time, how can I support the Mind Pump family? Here's one of the best ways you guys can. You guys love that Chimera coffee that we have. Chimera coffee with a K. You go to chimeracoffee.com, put in the discount code MINDPUMP for 10% at the checkout. If you guys have not tried Ben Greenfield's new bars out, they're fantastic. If you want some, go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/naturebite. Put in the code MINDPUMP and get 10% off. Go check it out.
Next up is NIH 32. If you were a head coach for a football team, how would you run your team? Would you be physically demanding and risk injuries, or would you take a different approach?
Can you tell which one Justin picked?
Yeah, I love this question.
Go ahead and start us off then, dude. Let's
hear it. I just think about this because of the way that I went through the entire experience and all the different levels. I only made it to the college level, but there was definite distinctive difference with, you know, the mentality, especially with the head coach position where, I mean, they want to establish this mental discipline. And I see this a lot on, you know, kind of the younger level where, you know, just trying to herd the kittens, you know, and get them all to really buy into the team dynamic and getting everybody to sort of put their best effort out there on the field, they tend to abuse that, and then they ramp up the intensity way too much. And, you know, this is always something for me going back and reevaluating, you know, kind of how I went through the process. Like, I totally would go back and tweak and modify things to where, you know, kids got the most benefit out of it, also saw the best result. So it's a very, very much, you're setting all these potential athletes up for problems they're going to hit as they mature and they get further along in the process. So, for me, it's always about starting off on the right foot, and to be able to establish, the way that you should properly train with recovery as an added element, to be considered is paramount. It's something that's crucial for kids to understand that, you know, I'm going to put this amount of effort in place in this situation, and then I'm going to build off of that. And how can I build off of that? By frequency, volume. I mean, this applies to skills. This applies to, you know, developing strength, developing power. They all fit in the same formula. So for you know, this to be an argument whether or not, you know, they should just blast their athletes to the nth degree, to me is silly. It's dinosaur. It's an old method.
It's not the old. I mean, some people have evolved from that though, right? Wouldn't you agree? I mean, I don't think they are all still fucking.
There's a lot of that still.
There's
a lot of that still, and you know, it's gotten better. The education's gotten better, but I think that And I can understand this is from a coaching perspective. Like, you want to establish mental discipline. So endurance is always one of those things that is overly exaggerated, like, or it's overly emphasized, I should say. That shouldn't be the utmost goal. Like, you can achieve you know, that type of an endurance, like, within the game, in less time than I think that coaches realize.
I tell people this all the time. We can move our VO2 max daily. And you cardiovascular adaptation is like takes 2 weeks. So it doesn't take very long. Obviously, those are all arbitrary numbers. But I mean, it does not take nowhere near as long in comparison like your other adaptations, like with muscular adaptations. It takes
and goes fast, right?
Yeah, you can manipulate. Yeah, you can manipulate cardio really quick. So I think it's, I would answer this the same way, Justin. I think it's, we kind of crack on sports teams all the time that actually are reaching for CrossFit as their tool to get their athletes in shape.
Yeah, you see that a lot now.
Yeah, so the ones that are doing that, I think that's silly. Like Justin's saying, you would phase your coaching out. I read the question different. I was reading it like, what kind of head coach would I be? And I was thinking in my head, like all the different types of coaches out there, like who am I more like? Mm-hmm. And I think an example, if you've seen As We Stand Tall or As We Stood Tall, that movie with, it's the movie about the De La Salle team. That first intro to that movie, I think the first 5 minutes is totally my style of leadership and how I would probably coach a football team. I get chills. I watch that the first 5 minutes of that show like so many times because I think it's such a powerful way of leadership.
Yeah.
And especially like with young football players.
Yeah, there's definitely a simplified method that I think that they struck a chord with, because when you're dealing with youth and then even like high school level and then kind of getting into college, like the more simple and the more structure of like really fine tuning the skill to make like only like 4 or 5 plays. We just mastered those 4 or 5 plays. Right. Like this is like for kids that are developing, I think this is the way to go as a coach to really just like really sharpen what it takes to make that run the most efficiently. And then we build off of that. So we build off of that in the next level. So now you're open to more responsibilities. You're open to more communication, you know, from other positions on the field. But like for now, let's keep these kids like really focused on what can improve, you know, their one very skilled position.
What's the quote by Bruce Lee? I fear not the man who has practiced 10,000 kicks once, but I fear the man who has practiced one kick 10,000 times.
Right.
Yeah, mastering the fundamentals.
That's it. So here's the thing. Like, what's the ultimate, if we're going to be honest, right? What's the ultimate goal for a coach? Is to win. Yeah. Okay. That's it. Like, that's the ultimate goal, is to be a winning coach with a winning team. The one thing that can prevent a team from winning more than all the others is injury. Injury will fuck up a team more than anything else. If you have your players are all hurt, you're fucked. I don't care how good your program is. I don't care how good your whatever. Everybody's hurt. You're fucked. So step number one is keep your players from getting hurt. And then number two is improving the performance. It's literally in that order. In fact, when I've trained young athletes, if we're in the off season, that's when I push them. When we're in season, that's when I step back and I'm like, okay, in season, my job is to keep you from getting hurt. And once I identify, you know, imbalances, I correct them. And, oh, this is a little tweak. Let me fix that. And your back hurts a little bit. Let me help you there. That's pretty much it. So there is no trade-off. Like, I think this question kind of implies like you push harder, but then risk injury, but then you get better performance. Or you push less hard, then you don't get injured, but you get less performance.
Lazy players.
Not true.
Yeah.
The most performance you'll get out of anybody, let alone a team, is by the appropriate approach, which is the one that doesn't injure them and maximize performance.
It's just like what we talk about with training the body.
Mm-hmm.
It is training the body. It's no different. It's just a different adaptation. We're talking about football, but it's no different than how we speak about building muscle or burning fat. You want to do the least amount of work to elicit the most amount of change. You're just flirting with that line a little bit more when you're talking about athletes like this, because you're trying to squeeze some endurance out of them. But it's exactly the same thing. You still want to approach their training very strategic and the way you coach them the same way. So it would be, that's why when Justin answered that way, I'm like, we're all going to answer the same way, because the same way we would treat a client who comes in and wants to lose 100 pounds. You wouldn't scream at them and sure, you could yell at them like Biggest Loser style and get her to lose the most weight in 1 week, but you know you'd be fucking her in the long term.
Well, yeah, and this is why, I mean, from the athlete perspective, like me going through the process, they tried so hard to develop heart. Like, who has more heart? Right? Who has that mental drive? Who has that discipline to do things when you're in adversity, you know, and when you're in these sort of positions where you have to overcome, and like football is like one of the ultimate displays of how to overcome adversity real time. And, you know, besides like combat sports and those types of things where it's like, you know, you have these immediate things that, you know, you have to like figure out like and problem solve like on the fly. And I think that, I mean, it's a critical part of the game. And it's definitely something that needs to be considered. However, like you said, like a lot of that needs to be expressed in the off season. And now like it has to be more of a mental focus, like, and less of a physical demand going into the actual performance of, you know, the game. And so we're trying to preserve the body, but we're trying to challenge the mind. We're trying to sharpen our ability to problem solve and do all that. And you can do that without like just grinding them into the ground.
Right. Again, that's going back to the analogy I gave with training the client who needs to lose 300 pounds. Like you want to push that, you want to push them towards their goals.
Yeah.
But you want to do it in a very methodical way. It's not just, I mean, I absolutely, which is how a shitty trainer would take over that. A shitty trainer handles a client the same way a shitty coach handles a team. Like, I mean, it's the same.
It's very reflective.
Right. Yeah. It's like, oh, I could just have these kids show up to double days and run them till they all throw up and then push them till, you know what I'm saying? And you just keep adding time and pushing them more. It's like, yeah, okay, well, a monkey can do that, you know?
They don't need a coach for that.
Yeah, they don't need a coach for that. What they need, though, what a really good coach.
It's lazy.
Would, yeah, right. You would know, be, would like, be.
Challenge them mentally. Challenge them on their responsibilities. Ask them questions, you know, if this, then what?
Right.
You know, and like really get them sharp on their answers and their critical thinking, and you'll do well.
Next up is that CH man 19. Are plyometric exercises more beneficial than isometrics? Which is better for sports, powerlifting, and weekend warriors?
Good question.
So they're both different. They both give different benefits, but mm-hmm. I guess the question is, you know, if you had to pick type of deal. I'll tell you something right now. Isometrics has way more applications than plyometrics.
Yeah, a lot more carryover.
Way more isometrics. Isometrics will affect so many different facets of your performance and your physique. Plyometrics will affect a few or less, I should say, than isometrics. Isometrics are also safer and can be performed with varying degrees of intensity. Mm-hmm. Plyometrics can be applied with one degree of intensity. It's all out explosive type of deal. Isometrics, it's funny to me because they're so, especially today, although you will see it's going to become a trend. Mm-hmm. Isometrics are super underutilized. Yep. And you know, they just don't get nearly as much credit as they deserve. There's very little individual techniques that I can think of that will give you more bang for your buck than proper isometric training.
15 degrees of strength increase on both sides.
Yeah, and people think of isometrics as like one, you know, like, oh, isometrics, I'm just going to squeeze my pecs. No, each range of motion, you can perform an isometric. You can, if I'm throwing a baseball, I can simulate isometrics in every piece of that throw with a tool like a stick or a wall or something like that. Bench press, deadlift, throwing, jumping, all these things. Isometrics gives you stability. Plyometrics does not give you stability. In fact, if you lack stability, you don't do plyometrics.
Justin, you're saying it's a 15 increase both ways, both eccentric and centric. Is that what the 15% is?
No, angular. So
yeah. Angular?
Yeah,
angular.
So if I do isometric here,
yeah,
then I'm going to get strength from 15 and 15
and 15
both
in front.
Oh, gotcha.
So it's not so specific. It's generally specific, but not.
I mean, it's pretty angular, yeah, specific.
Oh, I get what you're saying.
Strength, but yeah, it'll sort of irradiate and carry over into, yeah, those varying degrees.
15 degrees both ways.
Yeah,
so,
definitely.
But yeah, I mean, like, plyometrics definitely have their place. So it's not like, you know, like, in any case, like, I think what they're also asking is, like, so the weekend warrior versus, like, the athlete versus the powerlifter, you know, that kind of thing, like, what has the most application? So, you know, your weekend warrior, I would steer more towards actually the isometrics as being, like, where we're marketed mostly, like, P90X, and we're marketed all these types of, like, super intensive types of training when we're doing body weight, but it's mainly plyometrics being the focus.
But they're not real plyometrics. The way they do them on those programs is just to make you tired.
For exhaustion.
I was going to say Plyos for my sports, Isometrics for my powerlifting, and Weekend Warriors. If I had to divide them and do that, right? Like, who would I? Because you could argue either way. And anybody who's hearing us talk all great about Isometrics, for sure, going to get mad if you're training for sports and we neglect saying plyometrics, because you're going to be able to argue the carryover, not just from the explosiveness, central nervous system training, but also the cardiovascular endurance that you're going to get from the plyometrics that you won't get from the isometrics. So the carryover to that for the sports, I could see someone debating that. So to me, isometrics wins all the way across, except for in the sports category.
Well, with plyo though, are you really working your cardio? Right. Because
that's more central nervous system response.
It's more central nervous system, but you can apply it in ways that can include cardiovascular.
I mean. You know, here's the thing. Here's
more
where
so than isometric for sure.
Yeah, it depends, because I can go. I can definitely build strength endurance, which will carry over to a little cardio. But here's the thing.
Think about which one's more applicable to like sports where you're moving multi-planes.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Like, how many? It's a very small category of people that I would even apply plyometrics to. Like, most people. How many groups of people would you even have them try a plyo? You know what I'm saying?
Only athletes.
That's it, right?
Only athletes. Yeah.
And ones that are pretty well trained.
So that's why I say the plyometrics definitely not apply to the weekend warriors or the powerlifters. Isometrics 100% applies to those
that
two.
Makes sense.
And you could debate plyo and iso for sports, right? Because that's why I felt like you have to throw plyos in there for the sports person, is saying that that's better potentially for that. Although isometrics absolutely have their place, arguably in there too, and in a very close second. Mm-hmm. But for weekend warriors, like, I definitely think weekend warriors don't even need to include plyometrics. The benefits that plyometrics give, which I know everyone's seen all the studies and the marketing bullshit that you've all read, it's for a weekend warrior. There's a lot of other things I'd rather have you focus on that I think were, and talking about isometrics, I can have you do isometric holds that are going to work on your posture, that is going to give you way more carryover, change your life for the better, way more than teaching you an explosive box jump, you know?
Big time with that, because what you're doing with plyometrics, if you already have like recruitment patterns, like I'm basically the highest form of expression of my body. Like I'm doing now by doing a plyometric, but I'm doing it with poor recruitment patterns. So I'm basically heightening my poor recruitment pattern to the nth degree.
Right.
Versus like if I could just slow down and focus on, you know, compartmentalizing each part of the movement with isometrics, you know, I'm going to be able to see discrepancies there a lot more distinctively to work on, and I can work on that versus like I'm just gonna throw my body into the movement with shitty form with this plyometrics.
The beauty of isometrics is you can apply it to anybody. I mean, when I say anybody, I literally mean from the extreme beginner, the injured person, the person with compromised movement. In fact, I would probably start with isometrics. All the way to the most advanced athlete, could I apply isometrics? It can apply to everybody.
You know,
it's so moldable. Plyos or not.
Justin talking about the plyometrics on that, it makes me want to climb up on my soapbox for a minute, because this is one of the things that used to drive me fucking crazy about the fitness industry and a lot of at-home programs have taken this and have definitely gift wrapped it a fucking 100 different ways and sell the shit out of it. Mm-hmm. And plyometrics, really, I'll tell you right now, don't really have a lot of place other than training some athletes.
Yep.
If you're not training an athlete, and they have really marketed it hard towards weight loss, you know who I see do plyometrics? I rarely ever see an actual athlete doing plyometrics. The person I normally see in the gym doing plyometrics is the really overweight person that is trying to lose body fat because someone's fucking put a study up or showed something that shows how much more fat you burn when you do plyometrics. And so now you've got all these people jumping on boxes and doing explosive movements that have poor recruitment patterns, that have terrible proprioception, that have no business doing those movements, but are doing it because they read somewhere or saw something or got marketed to this way.
I don't think I've ever, in a gym, I don't think I've ever seen anybody do a plyo properly. I swear to God, like maybe once or twice, but I almost never do I see someone do a plyo. The way people do plyometrics is they do them
CrossFit
to get tired.
Yeah. Do them CrossFit style.
You know, they'll jump, and in between sets, and I'm going to do this other exercise right afterwards, and it's to get really tired. A plyo is similar to, think of it as you're just practicing to explode. Mm-hmm. You should not feel tired and fatigued. You shouldn't feel like your legs are going to fall off. By the time it gets to that point, you're no longer getting benefit from the plyo. It's literally, you should feel strong and fresh with every rep, and then when you start to feel fatigued, it's time to move on and do something else, because now that you have fatigue, you're losing any potential benefit you can get from the plyo. And that's really the truth. I think most people should stay away from plyometrics unless you're super, you're pretty advanced, you're an athlete, like Adam said. Isometrics, everybody gets benefit.
You have specific goals, right? So maybe you're not an athlete completely, but then for some reason you really want to increase your vertical. Yeah. And so you're working on that, or you really want to increase.
Goal specific.
Right. For if you have goals, or you're an athlete. Other than that, it don't belong.
Well, let me ask you guys this question. I don't even know if this study would exist, but I'd love to see it. Let's say you took a bunch of everyday regular basketball players, and you divided them in half, and one half you had them do plyos.
I already know you're going. One squatting barbell squat.
And the other one just do squats.
Yeah, the guy doing squats is
going to get more. They're going to get more vertical.
Well,
right?
You know,
now let's take it as
that's such legs. That's such a great. Well, that I'm an example of this, and many kids I'm sure that did this made the same mistake I did. Was I grew up in the era of the jump shoes.
Strength shoes.
Came in during my time in high school playing sports, and absolutely, we all bought them. We all had them. Mm-hmm. We all fucking trained in them. We all had
these big platforms, and basically your heel was suspended off of the ground, just so people know.
And San Jose State, actually, I saw this years
later.
All
these ruptured Achilles tendons.
Finally did a study, right? So the funny part is these shoes were around for many years, and they were a bunch of bullshit, and tons of people, I mean, somebody made millions of dollars, and tons of people have tried them and used them.
Shit, I bought them.
And there's no real direct studies on them, and there is now. I know there's probably plenty now, and I remember going to San Jose State maybe about, I don't know, 10 years ago, and in their kines department, reading a study, the professor there actually did a study on those shoes and compared it to squats. So like you're saying, so basically plyometrics comparing them to squats, and yeah, the squats absolutely destroyed.
Blew it away.
Yeah, jumping around on
fucking jump shoes. And so I'd like to take it a step further and have one group do plyos and one group just do proper full range of motion. When I say full range of motion, I mean isometrics from different ranges of motion, isometrics. I would venture to say the isometrics would perform a little bit better. No joke. Plyos are really good in combination with other shit. By themselves,
there
they don't really
should,
do much.
There actually should be studies on
there
all
should,
this.
There should, because this is, and yeah. I would really love to promote that, because, I mean, that's how my brain works. I'm like, if I could hyper-connect to different angles of this movement, like, really what it is you're accessing and you're telling your body, like, I need to produce this amount of force right now as quickly as possible. You know, what's the first operating system with that?
Tension.
Yeah. And it's also, it's neurological, so you need to be able to provide that stimulus, and that's not coming just from, you know, obviously you have to have access to the strength of it, but it really, I mean, you're commanding that. Mm. And so you have to be that connected to your central, nothing else I know that off the top of my head other than isometrics does that.
Right.
Good point. Quick commercial break. Hey, people ask us all the time how they can support Mind Pump. Here's what you can do. You can go to www.brain.fm/mindpump and get 20% off Brain FM for meditation or focus. You can also go to audibletrial.com/mindpump and get a 30-day trial plus one free audio book. Lastly, you can go to getnatureblend.com/mindpump and you will get a discount on Ben Greenfield's CBD product.
Trev Lucy, is there any friction between you guys because of your different lifestyles and personalities?
No.
Fuck these guys.
Not at all. We've talked about this before.
I mean, we argue and debate sometimes.
Oh, absolutely. Well, yeah, but
it's usually me and you, Adam.
Is there friction, though?
No, it's not friction.
Have you ever left work upset and mad at me?
Have I ever left? Yeah. No. I've left thinking like, fucking asshole.
Yeah, we crawled up his ass.
Yeah. No. You know, it's funny. Who did I ask the other day? Taylor. Because I don't remember what we were talking about. And me and you were getting at a big old debate.
Oh, it was the first time he'd seen that?
Yeah, we were getting a big old discussion, debate over something, and
he got all awkward and left.
Well, so yeah. Here's the thing. Like,
I know how these things work.
Here's the thing, and Justin,
I've been an observer.
Yeah. Both me and Adam were very passionate, loud, and expressive communicators. So when we both have a point that we want to make and they're different, or maybe we have a differing of opinions, it gets louder and more passionate, and it becomes a very good, and we're both very good at expressing our position.
Yeah.
And so it just goes back and forth. And it used to make people uncomfortable around us, but I think now everybody gets used to it and they know that it's all good.
You know what? And in their defense, for the people that have got to be around it for the first time or whatever, it is, let me tell you, I have worked with a lot of people in my life. For sure, probably the only person I've ever been able to do that with, to push it to that level and it still be very healthy. There's not a lot of people that still have, because I believe that even in it, we still have the awareness of knowing.
You're still listening to the other
right.
point of view.
And yeah. Exactly. And it's not about winning the argument, really. I am actually, that's a good point, mm-hmm. Jesse, because normally, like, you know, when I advise people and like helping people with like communication with each other, right? So rule number one is to not raise your voice and not argue and not fight, because that instantly shuts the other person off and they're no longer listening and they're just debating. Yeah. But when we actually get into these things, I'm actually listening very carefully of what he's saying, because I want to hear, like, I want to hear what he's so passionate about. I know that if he's saying something and he feels that passionate about it, he wouldn't do that. Like, you wouldn't fight. Neither one of us would fight the other one unless we really do feel strongly about something. And so here comes the important piece is I have so much respect for you that I know that I respect your opinion. I respect your intelligence. And so if you feel that passionate about it, I better listen to it. And even if you're wrong or I right, doesn't matter who's wrong or right. It's about getting to the best answer. And sometimes that's normally, or not some, most times this is what happens, is maybe we both go back and forth and maybe we even leave, which has happened before, where we leave it like, I don't know, I don't agree with you, I don't agree with you. And then all of a sudden a compromise happens where it's like a blend of what we both were kind of saying, like, you know what, I agree. Or someone goes like, all right, well, let's run this way, let's try this. And then, like, let's revisit it and see, and then we'll try it your way. You know?
Yeah, when you're with a team and you're working together, because we're on the same fucking team, like, we all have the same goal.
Yeah.
So it your ego does definitely, the ego never likes to be wrong, okay? It simply does not like to be wrong. So if I'm having a discussion or a debate with a teammate and I think the website should be blue, and I really fucking believe that blue is the color, and they say that it should be red, and they're super passionate about it being red, my ego really doesn't want to be fucking wrong. Even if while we're arguing, the other person makes a great point and shows me all this fucking evidence, and I'm like, holy shit, they might be right. My ego still doesn't want to be wrong, so I may still try to hold on to my guns. And so one of the most important things that I think we all do that's really good, and I think part of it's with our age and experience, and part of it is we're just all growth-minded, is that I've done this to myself, where I've been in an argument or a debate, and I've stopped myself halfway through and realized this is my ego now is starting to speak up a little bit.
Yeah.
So I'm going to take a step back, because at the end of the day, I don't give a fuck about my ego. I really don't care how good my ego feels. I want the best answer.
I think you're right. I think, honestly, a lot of it is years and wisdom and understanding what you're speaking upon, if it's upon your own ego or if it's upon what's really benefiting the group. And I think that we're able to decipher that sort of coming into the conversation. And a lot of the heated, you know, sort of squabbles, it's coming from like two really, like, you know, attractive options. Like these two options, like, could definitely exist, but one came from somebody's mind, one came from another. And now we're meeting somewhere where it's like, no, but this is really how I see it. And you're just, the passion comes from trying to describe and be heard. Because I think a lot of times what we're doing is, you know, we're so passionate and like myopic in the way that we think about it that, you know, like it's hard to get challenged
mean, like mid thought, mm-hmm. right? And so, and I think that's why it escalates. It escalates a little bit with like the tone gets louder, and then the other tone gets louder. And
well,
then again, but then it all sort of like, and I think for my role in that is really as the observer is to, you know, decipher both points, but also like interject one word in there, and then you both think about it. You know what I mean? And then that's like the seed that turns into what it really was supposed to be.
Well, I think here's one thing that's really cool is that I've never worked with a team where everybody knows when, and as individuals, each of us know when it's time to lead, and the rest of us know when it's time to follow, and it's happened. Yeah, with all of us.
Totally.
I've never been in a situation like that. Every situation, usually what I've been in is I've either early on in my career was following, and then for most of my career I was leading, and that was it. And what I'm learning from this is effective leadership is actually knowing when to follow as well. Even if you are just the leader, even if you are the boss, is knowing when you have that teammate or that employee even who's working for you, who you're just like, hey man, you lead. I'm going to do what you tell me. Because this is your wheelhouse or whatever, and we're all pretty good at that. It's almost like, you know, when the word says the question says friction, I haven't felt any friction with that. There's definitely been moments where I felt like I was leading, but nobody was like, you know, irritated about it or weird about it. And then there's moments where I was taking a back seat and I'm following, and I'm fucking happy doing that because I know that this particular whoever's leading at this moment. That's the person that should be leading at this moment. Yep. It's a very interesting. I've never been on a team like that before, so it's a pretty cool situation.
Well, it's talking about our lifestyles and personalities. So I'm trying to think of like lifestyle stuff and personality, like, you know, maybe the things that we're into. So none of this is 100%. Nothing's caused friction, but I can share with the audience like some things that are like definite lifestyle things that in personalities that are unique and funny and different. Like, you know, for sure. Sal is very routine about like he likes his gym time and his morning routine. And if he likes that, and if our scheduling gets in the way of that, I know it throws him off and he doesn't like that. So yep. Important. I've learned not to fuck with that. You know what I'm saying? It's like, okay, like he's got
to consistent,
right. He's got to get his workout in early in the morning. And you know, if what we're doing can wait later or do a different time, then so be it. Where I'm not like that. I'm bad about that. Like, I'm very inconsistent about what time I do it, and it's not as much of a priority. So, and that's important to him, and I know that, you know. So I've learned to be okay with things like that. That's a different personality trait. Justin, you know, one of the things that's different about his personality that I've learned over years too is like, if he's fucked up or there's something he needs to work on or something that he's struggling with, you got to let him work it out in his own head first. I can't come over and try and be daddy or
You can't pry from him. That's what I've noticed.
Yeah, like if he wants to share with you or if he wants your opinion or help, he'll ask it. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I've learned to be mindful of those times when I can see that he's kind of going through that.
I mean, so accurate about Justin. That's totally true. Yeah. You cannot pry. You know, we are pretty different in certain things. Adam, definitely. So here's something I've grown from working with Adam. Adam is he's very straightforward. And what I mean by that is we're all very straightforward. Okay, we're all of us are very honest and straightforward. But there's a certain amount of you know, when you're talking to people, there's a certain amount, I don't know, the word might be couth, maybe that's the wrong word, where you're like, okay, I'm not going to be offensive, so I'm going to say it this particular way. Whereas Adam just says it.
Yeah.
If you're not strong and confident in yourself and in what you're doing, or if you don't know Adam, you might just think he's just being mean to me. But then you realize, like, no, that's how he's talking to everybody. That's just Adam, and he's being very straightforward. Don't take it personal. This is how, and he'll take it. Like he's not one to dish it out and not take it. You can give it right back to him, and it's all good. And that's something that's different than I guess. Like I tend to word my words a little differently sometimes. So that may be a little different. What else?
Do you remember scenarios with each one of us? Like, I'm trying to think of the first time that I got that signal from Justin. Like, can you think of time or like, do you talk about that where I've been too direct to somebody? Have I been really direct to somebody recently?
No, you're just, you know, at first I remember thinking like, And this was really early on. And it wasn't, like I said, I respected you, so it wasn't a big deal. But I remember thinking, like, fuck, he's in a bad mood. Like, is he in a bad mood? Like, what's going on here?
Yeah.
And then after a few weeks, I was like, no, that's just sometimes he talks that way, but it's not, he's not mean. It's not really mean spirited. It's just
straightforward.
Yeah, it's just very direct. And it's all good. And to be honest with you, in business especially, it cuts the superfluous bullshit anyway. Yeah. Like, we don't need all that other stuff. Let's just
if you get past it, you appreciate it. Like, yeah. You just know. You know exactly what you're going to get as an answer.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah.
Doug is extremely easy to work with, I think, for anybody. I think I don't care who you are, anybody can work with Doug because he's a
chameleon.
Super hard worker, for sure, chameleon and just very aware of how he might be affecting someone.
And his lifestyle and personality, he, again, going to the chameleon thing, is that, I mean, he's definitely molded those things around us. Like, he's allowed us the freedom to, you know, I mean, it probably annoys him that I smoke pot in the studio sometimes, but, you know, he's like, whatever, if that's his thing. And I don't
know. He's learned to adapt.
Right. I don't abuse it either, because I'm sure he doesn't enjoy it or like it and stuff like that. But it's, you know, I think those are the type of things where allows a lot of flexibility with stuff like that, that may not be his style or his personality or lifestyle. So he is probably for sure the easiest.
No, I think all of us. As long as we, you know, because whenever you look at teams that succeed together, the thing that tends to get in the way later on is when egos get really big, and then you get people argue over who's doing who came up with what and who said this and I'm that and you're that, and that is a problem that I think any team will have, including ours. However, I'm so confident with us dealing with that particular issue because we all kind of check ourselves and check each other so well. And I honestly don't see any one individual getting to that point to where the other people of the team can't help that person rein that in, because mind pump's a lot bigger than it was when we first started, and hopefully it gets, you know, much bigger than that. And I could see us all just making sure we check each other and remembering the purpose of why we're doing what we do. And I don't see this ending anytime in the future as a result.
Yeah, I don't ever see friction from it either, because I think the way
just getting stronger.
All those things that we even just talked about each other, I think we all have viewed them as growth opportunities for ourselves, right? So I think that it never is a friction. If there's some of a disagreement, there's arguing, there's anything like where we don't see eye to eye, everyone has the awareness to look at it like, oh, there's an opportunity for growth. Me here, I could learn something more about either how this person does this or about that person. So I don't ever see friction.
Excellent. With that, check us out on YouTube, Mind Pump TV. In fact, we've actually done some videos on plyometric training. We talked about that earlier in the episode. We show some videos on how to do plyometrics properly. So there's a big difference between the right way and the way everybody else does them. Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, we have 30 days of coaching. It's free. It's basically just a ton of free information on fitness, wellness, health, and performance that we've compiled and compressed into easily digestible pieces of our episodes that are timestamped for you. We have bullet points. It's really valuable information. It's available for free. Also, if you want to ask us a question that we answer in an episode like this one, just go to Instagram, go on our page, Mind Pump Media, find the Q&A picture, ask your question underneath, and we may just pick it.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now, plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes, and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, And until next time, this is Mind Pump.